Hello and welcome! My name is Daniel from 3D Tutorial, and in this video I will show you how to rig a bouncing ball in Cinema 4D. And to create a ball, we simply grab a sphere object, and the sphere object has a radius of 100 centimeters. We don't care about it because our bouncing ball rig is scalable, and we can change the scale of the bouncing ball rig anyways, so we don't care about the radius at this moment. And to put our bouncing ball onto our ground plane, I set the right direction to 100 centimeters, and now our bouncing ball sits perfectly onto our grid. And let's create a new material, and in this material color textures channel I simply choose a surface tiles shader, and in this tile shader I choose the pattern lines 1, and for the grout color I choose an orange one, maybe something like this. Copy this one, paste it into the tiles color 1, and then I copy the tiles color 3 and paste it into the tiles color 2. And that's our material for the bouncing ball. And if we drag and drop it to our sphere, you will see we have these nice lines here. And if we squash and stretch our bouncing ball, we see a little bit better what's happening with our sphere mesh. Okay. Let's jump into the front view and think a little bit about what our rig can do, or what our animator can do with our bouncing ball rig. And for that I grab my Doodles paint tool here. And first of all we need a master controller, and with this master controller we are able to position our bouncing ball rig in the 3D space. And of course this master controller is scalable, so we have small bouncing balls, big bouncing balls, and we don't care about the scale of the sphere object. And then of course we need a move controller, and this move controller is underneath our master controller. And with the move controller our animator is able to move the whole rig around. And so everything what's following is underneath our move controller. And then to have the keyframes separately, the position keyframes separately from the rotation keyframes, we should create a new controller which we call rotate. So it's possible to have the position keyframes onto the move controller and the rotation keyframes onto our rotate controller, and not both together onto our move controller, so we can handle it a little bit better in the dope sheets, the F-curves a little bit better in the dope sheet, and it's more flexible for our animator, of course. And then we need an upper controller and a lower controller, and if we pull the lower and upper controller array from the center of our bouncing ball, we should get a stretch for our mesh. And if we pull the upper controller and lower controller to the center of our bouncing ball, we should get a squash for our mesh. And of course this both controllers are underneath our rotate controller, so if we rotate the bouncing ball around, maybe like this, our upper controller sits here and our lower controller sits here, and we can pull it away from the center, and we can have the squash and stretch in any directions in our 3D space. And I think that's it. That's how our bouncing ball could work. And let's create a rig for the bouncing ball. Okay, let's jump back into our 3D view and create controllers for our rig. First of all, we need a rectangle controller, and this rectangle controller needs to sit on the right plane. So we choose X, Z. And this rectangle controller has a width and a height from maybe 200 centimeters. Okay, wonderful. This is our master controller. And then we have our null object here, which is also in the center of our world, and we put our master controller underneath our null object. And this master controller gets a nice color, maybe a yellow one from our fast color scripts. Wonderful. So then we will create our move controller, also with the rectangle spline. Put it to the right plane, and this move controller has to be in the center of our bouncing ball. So I select my rectangle spline and choose the transfer command and simply click onto our sphere, and then I aligned the rectangle spline with the sphere's coordinates. So the rectangle spline sits perfectly into the center of our sphere, and we rename it to move, because this is our move controller, and we put it underneath our master controller, and the width and the height is maybe 180 centimeters. Okay, no, maybe 200 centimeters. Okay, that's great. And for the master controller, we change it back to 250 centimeters, maybe. Okay, looks nice. And the move controller gets a blue color. Okay, wonderful. Okay, it's directly aligned with the mesh. Maybe I set it back to 200 centimeters. Oh, 200 centimeters. Okay, wonderful, looks nice. And then we create a new controller. That's our rotation controller. I create it with a circle spline, and I put the circle spline also to the center of our sphere via the transfer command. Click in the viewport at our sphere mesh, and you will see the circle is in the center of our sphere. And the radius of this circle is maybe 110 centimeters. Okay, wonderful. Rename it to rotate and put the rotate controller underneath our move controller. So if we move it around, the rotation controller is following. If you put the rotate controller up and the move controller underneath your rotate controller, you will see if you move it, the rotation is not following, and you rotate, you cannot rotate properly. So the rotation controller is always underneath your move controller. And the rotation controller gets a nice color, maybe a red one. And you will see I have a bug in my script. It changes the angle to this one. I don't know why. We have to set it back to 5 degrees, and everything is nice and clean. The circle has a nice round shape again. Okay, wonderful. And then we need an upper and a lower controller. We created also with a rectangle spline, and I changed it to the right plane. This one is maybe 180 centimeters in the width and in the height. Okay, it looks nice. And that's our lower controller. which is here on the lower side of our sphere, and then we copy this lower controller and we set it in the right direction to 200 centimeters, so it sits perfectly on the top of our sphere. And as you can see, it's a little bit low poly. Of course, you can change the segments in your sphere if you need it. In this case, we want to have it at 24 segments to rig our bouncing ball. That's okay. And I renamed this one to upper controller. Okay. And we put this both controllers underneath our rotate controller, and we change the color maybe to green. Okay. It looks very nice. Maybe we can change the width and the height to 150 centimeters. Okay, that's wonderful. And let's check if everything is working as we expected, or as we planned it with our doodle tool here. I move the move controller around, everything is following, and also if I move the master controller, everything is following. We can rotate the rotation controller, and you will see the lower and upper controller is rotating with it, and so we are able to have a squash and stretch with the lower and upper controller in any direction. Okay, let's set everything back to its origin position, and of course we want to freeze the coordinates so we can set it back with the PSR commands, and the PSR commands in Cinema 4D R20 and R21 is not in the characters menu commands anymore, it's in the tools menu. Here you have to reset PSR commands, or if you don't find your commands, simply hit the shift and C key on your keyboard and you have this nice window here, and here you can simply search for your command and drag and drop it into your palettes. Okay, wonderful. Now I have it in the viewport. Remove it. Okay, and let's freeze the coordinates here. Freeze transformations, freeze all for the upper and for the lower controller. Rotate is okay, move is okay, master is okay. Okay, wonderful. And now we have to think about how we get the squash and stretch into our rig. Okay, let's take a look at how we build in the squash and stretch for our bouncing ball. And the most obvious thing would be to use the squash and stretch deformer here, and we put it underneath our sphere, and now we are able to squash and stretch our bouncing ball with this factor slider. And as you can see, it's very complicated to set up it properly, and you have way too much controllers to handle the squash and stretch, and as a rigger you are always searching for the easiest solution, and the easiest solution here could be to use a good and old one FFD deformer. So I select my sphere, hold shift and select the FFD deformer here, and grid points X I set to 2, and also for Y and Z directions. And as you can see, we have a perfectly sphere surrounding FFD box here, and we are able to select the points of this FFD box, and if I select all the four upper points or vertices, you can see if I pull it up, I get this stretch effect, but the volume is not plausible anymore. So we have to scale it in. And of course, we have to select the lower points of the FFD deformer, and we have to scale them also in. And then we have a perfectly stretched bouncing ball. And we can do this also with the squash. If I pull it to the center, you'll see I squash it. And if I scale it a little bit up, I can make the volume of the bouncing ball more plausible. And to handle this FFD vertices here in our rig system, we need to connect the vertex here to another object, which I can handle in my objects manager. And that's very simple. I simply create a null object, and I put this null object to this first vertex here, and then I copy this null object to the other side, and then I select both of them and copy them to the back side. And now if you select the FFD deformer and select the first point, and here we choose the structure manager, we can see the index of the selected vertex here, and that's 2. And for this one, we have 3, 7, and 6. 2, 3, 7, and 6. Then I select my null object, rename it to 2, 3, 7, and 6. Then I select them all and copy it to the lower side here. And we rename them also. So I select my FFD deformer, select the vertex here, and that's the index 0, 1, 5, 4. 0, 1, 5, 4. Rename them 0, 1, 5, 4. And we renamed all the null objects properly to use them inside Expresso, because we have to connect the vertices with the null objects, and we will do this with Expresso. So I create a new Cinema 4D text Expresso tag onto my sphere object, and here I drag and drop my FFD deformer in, and I want to work with the object FFD, so I select object, and to connect the null objects with the vertices of the FFD deformer, I need a new node, and that's an Expresso general node point node. And with this node, you are able to access the point index of the object's points. So I connect this object with the points node, and here I can choose an index, and of course I can connect the point position with my null objects. So I drag and drop all my null objects in, and you see something is happening, and that's because the point position is 0, 0, 0 for point index number 0. So you will see the point 0 is in the center of our 3D world space. And if I connect my first null object which is called zero. With the points node, I have to choose coordinates, global position, of course, and then I connect it, and you will see this vertex or this vertex of the FFT deformer is snapped to or is connected to with the null object, and I can move it around, and you see we are able to control the vertices of our FFT deformer. So I will do it for all our null objects, and then we have to think about how we can handle this squash and stretch. Okay, and to handle all my null objects, I create two new spline objects, and for this I choose an ansatz, choose the right plane, and maybe the radius of this ansatz is 50 centimeters. The first one is on the bottom of our sphere, that's right, and the second one is on the top of our sphere, that's right, so we call this one n upper, and this one we call n lower. Wonderful. And now we can put our null objects underneath the n upper and the null objects which are sitting on the ground plane, we put underneath our n lower. And now we are able to handle the whole FFT thing here. And these two objects are inside the rig, so our animator shouldn't choose these objects. The animator should handle the whole thing with the lower and upper controller we've created. The NX are only for us, for the rigger. We put this N lower underneath our lower controller and the N upper underneath our upper controller. And to make everything nice and clean, the upper controller is here and the lower controller is down the upper controller. And I've created this 2NX. Of course, to scale everything in and to scale everything out. And the scale is now 1, 1, 1 for every direction, and that's the default position. Let's take a look at our front view. I simply delete our first doodle object and I create a new doodle here. How we calculate everything inside Expresso. Okay, choose the doodle tool, doodle paint. Here we have our upper controller, here we have our lower controller, and if the distance from these two controllers is bigger than the default position, which is this one, so the distance gets bigger like this. Okay. Bigger. We want to scale this ansatz we have created in. So we scale it in. And if the distance is smaller than the default distance, so like this, this one gets smaller, we want to scale the end side out. So our job now is to measure the distance between the n upper and the n lower. And then if the distance is bigger, we need to scale the n lower in side, and of course also the n upper inside. And if the distance is smaller, we need to scale the n lower outside and the n upper outside to get a squash. And we will do this with an new espresso tag, because we want to calculate the whole measuring or scaling thing before we connect the null objects with the FFD deformer. So I create a fresh espresso tag here, and we make sure this one is sitting before our first espresso tag, in which we connected the null objects with the points of our FFD deformer. And here I can drag and drop in my n upper, and I can drag and drop in my n lower. And we said we want to scale them, so we choose the coordinates scale, and for the n lower also scale. Okay, and to measure the distance, I can simply drag and drop in my lower and my upper controller, but that's not very clean. So I convert the lower controller to a new null object and put this new null object underneath my lower controller, and I rename it to position lower. And I convert my upper controller to a new null object, and I rename this one to position upper. And we can drag and drop in this two new null objects. And as output port, we can simply use the coordinates global position, coordinates global position, and to measure the distance between these two null objects, we simply choose a new node, espresso calculate distance node, and we connect everything. So global position upper with input port 1 and global position lower with input port 2. And to see the result, we simply choose a result node and connect it with the output port. And our distance is now 200 centimeters. If we choose our upper controller and pull it away from the center, you will see our distance is changing. And we can simply say calculate animation refresh, so we get always an update if we move something around. And the distance is changing, but we said we want to measure the default distance always, and to save the default distance, we could say, okay, we use an absolute node and we say, okay, the default distance is 200 centimeters. But if we scale our rig, the espresso doesn't know the actual distance. So it's more obvious to create some new null objects for that. And I simply copy my position upper and position lower null object underneath my move null object, and I rename it to position upper default, and default is D, position lower default. And These two null objects are not changing because they are underneath my move controller, and we always get the default distance for them. So we have to put it inside the expressor, and we do the whole thing again. Coordinates, global position, coordinates, global position. We simply duplicate our distance node and connect everything. And here we simply connect the new result node. And you'll see we have the default distance of 200. And if we do it with an absolute node, we can put in 200. But if we scale our rig with our master controller and the objects mode, we scale it, you will see the absolute input is not changing. And if we connect it to our distance node, you will see the distance, our default distance is changing with it. And that's very great because we can use this to have always the correct default distance between this lower and upper controller. And so our rig is, of course, perfectly scalable. Okay, let's delete our absolute node here. And now it gets a little bit complicated. But first of all, do the simpler part. And the simpler part is to drive the scale parameters of our ansites. So I create a new node, which is called Expresso Calculate Range Mapper. And the driving parameter is the distance between our position upper and position lower null objects, which are underneath our upper and lower controller. So if the animator is moving this one around, the distance is changing here, as you can see, if I connect the output with my result node. We have a changing distance. So this is the driving parameter. The output port is connected with the input port of the range mapper. And if I connect the output port with a result node, we get 200 as a result. But for the default state, we need a scale of 1 for our ansites, as you can see here. And to get this scale, we can simply put the output lower parameter to 1, and we get 1 as scale. And to calculate the right default distance within the range mapper, I simply connect the output port of my distance position upper and lower default with the input lower port. So that's right, and the input upper must be 0. So if I connect this one with the scale and I move my upper controller around, you will see nothing is happening, and that's because the output upper is 1, and it has to be at least more than 1 to get a scaling for the ansites. So I simply set it to maybe 2, and now you will see I have this scaling. Wonderful. But if my animator is moving this controller to its limits, you will see we have this inverse scaling. So we have to stop the scaling at maybe this position here. And for this one, I can create a new range mapper. So I copy this one. And in this range mapper, I do the same one as in this one. I connect my output port with the input port and input lower port with the output of this distance here. And the input upper in this node must be the same as the parameter we get out of this distance node. So I can connect the input upper with the output of these two null objects. And in this node, the output lower is 1, but the output upper must be less than 1. So I maybe put in 0.1. And then I connect it with the scale here. And if I move my controller around, you will see nothing is happening. And that's because the input lower and input upper is the same at the moment. So I need to multiply the input upper parameter with something. And that's our factor. So I create a new Espresso calculate math node, and we said I want to multiply it with something. So I connect output with the input and then the output with the input upper, and to multiply it with something more than one, of course, I set this input 2 port maybe to 2, and then as you can see I get the scaling back. And as you can see, we have the inverse scaling, of course, and that's because we have to clamp the upper parameter. So I check clamp upper, and then if I move my controller, you will see it stops. And that's what we need. Wonderful. So you are maybe asking, why do we have two range mappers here? Because this one is working perfectly. If I move my upper controller, we get the stretch. And if I move my lower controller, here we get a squash. And that's perfectly working. But in our rig, it is possible to change the squash and stretch factor. And we have two states. We have the first state, this is a stretch, and we handle the stretch with this range mapper here. As you can see, if I crank up in my multiply node the input 2, I can change my stretch factor. And for the squash, I cannot handle the squash factor in this range mapper. So I need this another range mapper, which I can connect with my scale input ports of the end sides. And here I can change the squash factor with the output upper parameter of the range mapper. And that's why we need two range mappers. So let's set everything back to its default position. And now we have to compare the distance of our position upper null objects with the distance of our default null objects. And if the distance is bigger, we want to have the output of this range mapper, which is handling the stretch. And if the distance is smaller, we want to have the output of this range mapper, which is the squash. So let's create a new compare node, Espresso logic compare, and we are comparing these two distances, the position upper and position lower distance I put into the input 1 port, and the output of the default null objects I put into the input 2 port. And if I connect my result node with the compare node, and We have said we want to check if this distance is bigger than this distance. So I have to set up the right function. It is bigger than, you will see we get as result 0 because it's the same at the moment. And then if I move my upper controller, the distance should get bigger. And you will see I get as output 0. And if the distance is smaller, you will see I get as output 1. And with these two states, I can switch between my two range mappers. And to switch between these two range mappers, I need another node, which is called Expresso Logic Condition Node. And this condition node can have two inputs. And we can switch between these two inputs with the switch parameter here, which is driven by the compare node. So I can connect the output of my compare node with the condition switch parameter, and then I can connect my range mappers with the input 1 port and this range mapper with the input 2 port. And then we can connect the output of the condition node with the scale of our ansights. And then if we switch, we get the different results back of our condition node. So here we have the squash and here we have the stretch. So this condition node is switching between these two range mappers. And as you can see here, I have the stretch and I change my multiply parameter, maybe to 3. I can change the stretch factor. And then if I move my upper controller to the lower controller, I can change in this range mapper the output upper parameter to change the squash factor. And that's how the condition node is putting out the different outputs of our range mapper. So let's set everything back to its default position. And now we have to give the animator access to the stretch and squash factor. And we will do this with some user data. And we put this user data maybe to our bouncing ball null object. Here we create some new user data. And the first one is called squash factor. And this must be an integer. And the squash factor shouldn't be more than 10. Okay. And of course, the squash factor needs to have a default state, and the default state is 2. As you can remember, if we take a look at our Expresso, we have a default state of 2 for the multiply, and we have a default state of 2 for the output upper. So we have to create a default state for the squash factor. Here, default value is 2, and the minimum limit is also 2. And then we can simply copy this user data. And I rename this one to stretch factor. Wonderful. Hit OK. And now if I crank this up, it's possible to crank it up to 10 and not more to 10. And if I crank it down, it's possible to crank it down to minimum 2 and not less than 2. Okay, wonderful. It's working, and now we have to connect this user data with our Expresso. That's very simple. I simply drag and drop this null object into the Expresso. As output port, I search for my user data squash factor and user data stretch factor. And then we have the rehandling the stretch factor with the multiply object here. So I put in the stretch factor into the input port of the multiply, and the squash factor we are handling with this range mapper output upper parameter. So I connect this one with the range mapper output upper parameter. Wonderful. And now if we check if everything is working, upper controller moving to this position, we have this stretch, and the stretch is stopping at this point. And here I can crank up my stretch factor. Wonderful, it is working. And then I move my upper controller to the lower controller, and I'm crank up the squash factor. It is also working. And then if I scale my rig, nothing should happen. Only scaling should be performed. Wonderful, it's working. And if we check it with the stretch, it's also working. Wonderful. And at any scale state, we can change the parameter here. Here the squash factor, the stretch factor to 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10. Wonderful, it's working. And here, if I move it to the lower controller, I can change my squash factor. Okay, wonderful, everything is working. I reset everything back to its default position, and then I simply hide my FFD deformer here. I hide my N lower object and my N upper object. Only the controller are visible. We create a new layer and rename it to bouncing underscore ball. Copy this one, put it underneath the bouncing ball layer, and rename it to bouncing ball height and locked. And I delete my doodle object, put in the bouncing ball null object here. All the controllers we put in here, and all the other things, maybe I change the color here to green. All the other things I put underneath my bouncing ball height and locked layer. Okay, wonderful. And now the sphere, of course, to the bouncing ball layer. I hide and lock my hide and locked layer. And then we have to set up the right protections for our rig. So the master controller should be possible to move around, to rotate around, and to scale around. So this one has no protection. The move controller is only able to be moved around. So I don't protect the position parameter here. The rotate controller is only able to be rotated around. So I unlock my rotation parameter here, and the upper controller should be only moved. So we lock the rotation and we enable the position. And that's it. We finished our bouncing ball rig. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Thanks for watching. See you soon and goodbye.